Another podcast. Again, thank you for tuning in another week. We're super excited for today's episode because Jamie and I have been trying to get the CEO of Champion X, Sivan Sankaram Somasundaram, or also known as Soma, for I would say 6 to 7 months of us just trying to pin him down because he's a very busy man. And we're just so excited to finally share his story with all of you. He inspired us when we listened to a few of his interviews in the past, and just his leadership is something that we look up to, and you're going to be blown away by his story and just how he leads his company. So a little bit more about Soma before we get started, because I'm already excited. As you can tell, I want to get straight into it, but let's give him a good bio. So he's a president and chief executive officer of Champion X, and he serves on the company's board of directors. Soma has led the company in these roles since its spinoff from Dover Corporation in 2018 and through its transformation merger in 2020, when the company added chemical technologies to its portfolio and changed its name to Champion X Corporation. He received a bachelor's degree in mechanical engineering from Anna University in India and a master's degree in industrial engineering from the University of Oklahoma. So Soma, thank you so much for being here today. We're very keen to listen to you and learn from you. So thank you for accepting our invite.
Well, thank you. I'm humbled and grateful to be here. And and I really appreciate all you do for the industry and the younger generation. So thank you for all you do.
Thank you, Soma. And, you know, I really want to start off with your childhood, and before we even started, you kind of went into the origin of your name, which I thought was really interesting. So we really want to dive into that. But more importantly, we'd like to hear about how your father really instilled those leadership qualities that you have today, and really the impact that he had on your life.
Yeah, Jamie, you know, I mean, just a little bit about my name itself, right? And you know, as you know very well, India is a very diverse country with lots of different languages, cultures, traditions. It's, what I would call it, it's like a mosaic, you know. And in many ways, I'm really grateful that I had an opportunity to grow up in India, you know, and we can talk about how that shaped my thinking around diversity, inclusion, and those elements, right? So with going back to the name, you know, the part of India I come from, which is the southernmost part of India, you know, as you know, India is a peninsula. So the southernmost tip of India, where there are like three seas or oceans meet, the Bay of Bengal, the Indian Ocean, and the Arabian Sea meet. You know, from that tip, I'm about 50 kilometers where I grew up, right? And that part of India where I grew up, in it is called Tamil Nadu, where we speak, my mother tongue is Tamil, is the concept of first name, last name does not exist, right? Everybody is given one name. And in my family, the tradition is, it's a long-standing tradition. It just changed nowadays, but in those days, it's the firstborn son gets the father's name. The second born son gets the mother's father's name. And then I was the third born son. So the first two names are taken. So they gave me my grandfather's brother-in-law's name. So that's how I ended up with my name. So I got only one name, which is Soma Sundaram. That's the only name I got, Soma Sundaram. The way they differentiate between two Soma Sundarams, you know, in the class, is you adopt your father's only name, the first letter of that name, as an initial. So if you go back and look at all my records, school records and everything, it will simply say, yes, Soma Sundaram. So yes, dot Soma Sundaram. It's just an initial.
Oh, wow.
And that's how they differentiate between two names. Now you may ask, what if two people have yes, Soma Sundaram? Right? So what they do is they add the next initial. It could be the mother's father's name, or it could be the place they come from, you know. So that's how the thing goes. But obviously, when I came to US, United States, you know, initially I started getting letters which says DRS, you know, because everybody thought S is my first name. And so, but they said like, hey, why don't you expand your initial to make it a first name? So my official name became Sivasankaran Soma Sundaram. So actually Sivasankaran is my father's name. It's actually my father's name. So that's the origin of the, so this is kind of a little unique to the part of India I come from. If you go to other parts of India, they have family names and all that, just like first name, last name type of thing. Because of my long name, you know, so when I came to University of Oklahoma, you know, that the name of Soma was given to me by the graduate admissions assistant, secretary, if you want to call it, I mean, who was, you know, the first point of contact when you walk in and they check you in and all that. And she just looked at my name and said, hey, this is too long. You know, you need a shorter name. Maybe we can go with Soma, you know. So that's how the name stuck. So right from there on, it just, everybody calls me Soma. And that's perfectly fine. Like one of the person used to tell me, all famous people have one name, like Cher, Prince. Yeah. You know. I'm not famous. I'm not famous, but I have one name, you know, so.
Thanks for sharing that story, Soma. So tell us a little bit about your upbringing in India. What did life look like growing up? And how did this young boy from the southern tip of India end up in Oklahoma? And then now CEO of, you know, a Fortune, I would say 500 company, or that's on the stock exchange. Like, how does one do that?
Yeah, I mean, I never knew these things will happen growing up, right? I mean, it's a journey, and the journey evolved. I've been blessed and grateful for all the people who helped me along the way, and more importantly, willing to take a risk on me, because there's a lot of talented people in the world, right? So my childhood goes back to a little village where I grew up, you know, because my father was the teacher in the village. And, I always felt that, growing up, you never think about these things, who is your role model or things like that. So I never thought about my father as a role model. Just like any other family, I grew up, loving parents, but even though it's a village, it's a very humble kind of growing up. But, you know, a lot of love, just growing up, right? But as I went on, and as I got more into leadership roles, and when you start reflecting on your own, you know, who you are, your self-awareness, what's your leadership style like? And when I started reflecting on it, I could trace back a lot of who I am as a leader today and how I operate as a leader. I can trace back to the service mindset my father had as a school teacher in a small village, where he dedicated his life, you know, pretty much to educating poor children, you know, because as you know, in villages, typically, you know, a lot of the kids will go to farming early on, and so he will make sure that he gets up early in the morning, make sure he grabs those kids before they go out to the farms, or he will stay back later in the night to teach them and continue to educate them. And because he fundamentally believed education is an important stepping stone for generations to benefit, right? Mm-hmm. So I think when I look back at it, you know, just observing that really probably shaped my thinking about this idea of enabling people to do great work, right? So you are simply enabling these kids to learn and hopefully have a better future. So when I look at leadership today, what is the job of leaders? The way I think about it is a job of us as leaders is to help enable people to do great work, right? I mean, that's in a simple way I think about it. You know, how do we enable people to do great work, right? So that's kind of the way the childhood evolved. So all my education was in and around that. And for college, I came to a bigger city, the mechanical engineering you mentioned, Anna University. And that was in a bigger city called Chennai. That's where I, you know, did my Anna University, and then worked in India for about 4 years before coming to University of Oklahoma for my graduate program.
When you went to university, did you think that, you know, before picking that school, Or did you have aspirations to ever lead a big team? Or did you dream of leaving India and coming to the US? Or did you ever see that as an opportunity for you, given where you were at the time?
Yeah, I would say that, I did not have that kind of a vision or thinking that I need to go lead a bigger team or, I did not have that. But what I did have was, I'm generally, my tendency is to be very curious. So curiosity is something it's kind of inherent to me. And so when I was working in India for 4 years, and obviously, I had several of my friends who went to US to do graduate programs. So that curiosity piqued my interest. And, so as I worked, I was able to save some money, which enabled me to, look at, hey, maybe I'll go to US and study for graduate program, which was very common at that time. Mm-hmm. And even today, it's fairly common. So that's what led me to University of Oklahoma. And people sometimes ask, well, how did you choose University of Oklahoma? I think, coming from a humble background in India, to me, it's the cost effectiveness and, is an important aspect. And University of Oklahoma kind of matched my interest, but more importantly, the cost of living and the cost of going to school was something which I could afford. And I was able to take some loan, which my uncle guaranteed. And I was able to come. So I think that was the whole story around it.
Can you tell us a little bit about when you arrived to Oklahoma, with your luggages, you're starting a new life in the US. What kind of, how did you feel when you arrived to the US? It's the first time, was it the first time you had ever stepped foot here before?
Yeah.
Especially Oklahoma, where I would say it's not super diverse as much as other, parts of the US. And you look different. Your name's different. The accents are different between people from Oklahoma and your university. How did you adapt to that? Because that's a big change, especially later on in life, right? You're probably in your early 20s. It's different when parents immigrate here with their young children and they go to school, and it's difficult. But you're a kid and you can adapt easier than I would say like a young adult. How did you handle that?
Yeah, no, great question. I mean, it's in multiple dimensions, right? You have to adapt, including the weather, right? I mean, I never experienced winter in my life. In fact, I didn't even own a sweater until I came to Oklahoma, right? Because where I grew up, it's always summer or a big, good summer. That's all it is, right? And so few things really helped, right? Number one, University of Oklahoma, there's a good, what I would call it, international student population. So that helps, right? I mean, including students from India. So when you go there, you can see people, there are people who can help the student population who has already been there. They kind of tell you what, show you the ropes, and they where to go for grocery or where to go to. So there's a bit of a support structure there. The second event was, at that time, and I'm sure University of Oklahoma still does it, University of Oklahoma did a great job. They had their international student office. They really had a great program and job of, bringing in the students and helping them integrate with the. So what they did was they assigned these host families, So the families in the Norman area, they volunteered to take on students, as a host. So what they do is in important events like Thanksgiving, Halloween, because the concept of Halloween does not exist in India. Mm-hmm. The concept of Thanksgiving, in the shape and form, it does not exist there, right? So what they do is in this important events, they invite students home. And the student family, Bill and Dolores Krueger, they were fantastic people, so they showed me what Halloween means and what, there are a lot of, obviously being new in the culture, there's a lot of funny stories about, these things, but but they really showed me the ropes of what this means and really helped me integrate and appreciate the culture. So that was a second thing. And then third thing I would say is, you know, growing up in India, as I mentioned, it's a very diverse place. So it's somewhat easier, you know, you don't, you know, our diversity it comes easy, you know. Mm-hmm. So when you come look from across people who are different or new, or your mindset is very open. So that helped as well. But I give a lot of credit to the University of Oklahoma as an international student program that really helped us.
You know, you mentioned a few times, you know, the impact of growing up in such a diverse culture, and then also coming into an organized or coming into a university where you were really one of those, you know, standouts that was different, but you were supported and you learned how that felt. You know, how does that impact your leadership style today and building a culture for Champion X and understanding the pain points that some people might get by coming into a new company or maybe not looking like everybody else, because you felt that and you had that throughout, you know, your childhood, but also university to now. You know, how have you used, you know, your experiences to build the culture that you have today?
Yeah, you know, I think for me, you know, one of the convictions, you know, which shaped my thinking in this area is all about, you know, how experiences shape people's, you know, belief systems, right? And, you know, we subscribe to the idea of the culture by design, you know, you might have heard me say, you know, leaders get the cultures they deserve. And I think, you know, because culture is an artifact, right? You know, it's an artifact which exhibits itself. And the way the artifact exhibits is, you know, experience shapes people's belief system. And that belief system over a period of time results in behaviors. And those set of behaviors, you know, forms that artifact of culture, right? So which means, I'll go say it another way, if you want positive culture, you want a collaborative culture, you want a constructive culture, start with giving people those experiences, right? Because you cannot change the artifact without giving the right experiences. So going back to the question of, so how has that shaped how we build culture? So the starting point for us for building the culture is starting with experiences. So people, you know, provide positive experiences, constructive experiences, collaborative experiences, right? So, and that shapes over a period of time people's belief system. And when they can see the sincerity, when they see authenticity in people, trust people who are sincere, you know? So when you make a sincere effort to provide good experiences to people, then that over a period of time shapes the culture. So that's where, you know, I start with for shaping cultures is the experiences people have.
Mm. Wow. No, it's so important, especially like you mentioned in terms of leadership style. Let's talk about, we heard on one of the podcasts that you were on that you have a special email where employees can reach out to you, which I find really amazing, because sometimes when you look at a lot of companies, there's a big disconnect between the top leadership and the people on the floor, right? What made you decide to do that? Because that's not very common, where a CEO wants to really hear from the people. And how do you handle sometimes, like, you have a lot of big responsibilities, but you're also hearing out different things that need to be like fixed within the organization. How do you handle not stressing out or sleeping at night when you have so much going on?
Yeah, no, great question. You know, as a leader of an organization, whether you are a leader of a 5-people organization or a 5,000-people organization, one of the important aspects is how do you align the organization around a set of things that people can align around and believe in, right? And the power of people is around alignment and engagement, right? Imagine if we have a 7,000 people organization, imagine the power of 7,000 people if they can align around a set of things and stay engaged, mm-hmm. right? And that's the hardest thing to do as a leader, right? And especially when you do work in 55 countries, you know, try to align people, right? So you have to look at multiple mechanisms by which we do that, right? So the first one is, you know, as you know, we are a purpose-driven organization. And so everything for us starts with what is the purpose of the organization? And then what's our operating culture and philosophies, right? And then supporting that is, are we creating, are we being sincere to that, right? So one of the aspects we always talk about it is being humble, and the humility is a big part of our culture. And we want to make sure that we are transparent, we are honest about who we are. So in order to hear what exactly is going on or how people are feeling, I said, you know, let's start this. There's a pipeline to CEO, we call it. And so it is another mechanism for people to reach directly to me and express what they want to express. And this idea of being transparent, what we do is we not only I will answer every one of those emails, but we'll also post every one of those questions and answers on our company intranet so every employee can read. As you can imagine, you know, having 7,500 employees, obviously, you know, we make decisions which may or may not, you know, be liked by everyone in the organization. So when you look at the distribution of those mails, right, there are set of emails I get which are very positive, you know, really appreciating the openness and transparency. There are a set of emails I get where people are recommending and suggesting ideas, right? Mm-hmm. Hey, we should be doing this. How about this? How about that? But then there are a set of emails I get where people didn't like, you know, the decision we made, or they are not experiencing the type of culture I talk about in their little area, mm-hmm. you know? And they take time to write about their disappointment in that, right? And when we can publish that openly across the company, right? And I think people can see and say, you know, wow, this is good transparency we can see. Not everything is, you know, great all the time, because we have a long way to go to improve, continuously improve. So I think, you know, the mechanism provides a means for people to talk about things. And I'm truly grateful for every one of those emails, because when people take time to write to me, mm-hmm. right, which means they really care, you know, right? And then that's how the process started. We've been doing it for 2 years. And every, you know, on an average, I get anywhere between 2 to 3 a week, you know, from different parts of the world. And I'm grateful for that.
Yeah, that transparency is just incredible, that you publish them as well so that everybody sees what's going on. And like you said, sometimes from the top, you want to make a good culture and you have, you know, you're showing up every day to try to make the best culture. But there are these little pockets in different parts of the organization that you can't control how, you know, that manager is necessarily leading the team. So it's really nice that you have like that opening there. We had a question on representation matters. It was one of our events, and it's a big topic for us because, as you know, two young women going up in our careers, we look up to the top to see if anybody looks like us. Sometimes when I look at companies to see if I would be interested in exploring something there, I look at their board of directors on the website, and if everybody looks the same, it's a huge red flag for me. And I think the new generation, we're thinking about that. So when you were going up in your career, did you find representation mattered for you? Did you want to see another person from India make it to the top in, you know, certain companies? Or how did you handle that when you didn't necessarily have someone that you can lean on as a mentor that, you know, looked like you?
Yeah, no, great question. And I completely agree with you. You know, I think the people seeing themselves in the organization, the sense of belonging and seeing themselves in the organization is absolutely critical for engagement and for people to, you know, feel that they are, that the organization is inclusive, right? So, you know, for me, you know, when I was, the curiosity aspect of me helped a lot, you know, because even though in times those early days, there is not many of people from India in the leadership positions in oil and gas industry. But there were in the growing technology industry, I could see there is more of leaders there. So that gave me motivation. Mm-hmm. And assuming positive intent is an important thing for me. You know, so by nature, I assume positive intent on everything I engage, right? So which means, you know, look, if you work hard, you know, if you demonstrate what you can do, you know, you will continue to progress. And I was fortunate in my career that there were people who took a risk on me, right? And so through the period, I really, you know, was able to progress through and, you know, learning through that, saying that how important that people can feel a sense of belonging in the company, which is critical to the engagement, shaped my thinking as we, when I got a chance to continue to become a senior leader, with that making that a priority within the organization.
You know, knowing that and seeing what you went through, and also, you know, you were a CEO numerous times, you know, before ChampionX, you know, where have you seen women really being held back, and why, what have you noticed to be kind of what keeps us from getting to the top? Because in oil and gas, it's still a very, very small percentage of women that even hold, you know, leadership, have that even be vice president positions. At the Representation Matters event, we had Kim McHugh, and she was one of the first executives to hold such a position in an operations role at Chevron. That was a huge, you know, glass ceiling break for us as women, but still that was, you know, just 2018, which is not really that long ago, and we're still struggling in that space. So, well, from your opinion, you know, how can we overcome that, and where do you see, you know, the biggest hurdles?
Yeah, I mean, I think it, for me, you know, the number one issue we face is starting with this unconscious bias, right? Because it is almost like people assume mm-hmm. that, so, you know, women may not be interested in these type of things, right? That's a very unconscious bias people hold, that, you know, I think we need to start with the idea of, you know, breaking those unconscious bias, right? Because this idea of equal, you know, opportunity, you know, and making sure that there's good representation starts with the idea of, you know, starting with a diverse slate to begin with, mm-hmm. right? And that's one of the things we really drive is, you know, don't take the easy path. Don't take a come and say, well, you know, we already have a person we thought of, right? Start with the diverse slate. You know, why can't we find, you know, two more women who is interested in this type of role? Let's go find it. Let's go find them, right? And I think, you know, we, starting with me as a CEO, we have to champion that, right? And that's one of the reasons I chair the Diversity and Inclusion Council. And then in addition, I also want to make sure that there's a high level of representation in the Diversity and Inclusion Council, which, you know, up and down the organization as well, you know, not just, you know, only the senior leaders on diversity, so, but all the way to our ERG leaders sit on the table, you know, to make sure that we are driving mm-hmm. the idea of, you know, diverse slate. And if you look at the goals and metrics we have, you know, we have specific metrics around, you know, women as people leaders. What is our today's percentage of women as people leaders? And then where are we going to go? Today, we have about 24% of our people leaders are women, which is still low, right? I mean, for me, so we have got a 5-year goal that we need to move that needle to 30% of our leaders in the population are women leaders, which means we have to disproportionately need to promote and identify and promote these leaders. And it can be done, you know, if we stay disciplined and insist on the process, mm-hmm. right? So I think there's a lot of, in my opinion, like, you know, look, there are some practical things we have to work through, but I think it has to start with the idea of breaking that mindset. There's no reason, you know, why we have, you know, as an industry, we are only 20%. gender diverse as an industry, right? No, I understand, you know, that, you know, we, you know, a big part of, for example, in our company, right, 70% of our positions don't offer flexibility, mm-hmm. right? Because they work in the field, they work in manufacturing plants and so on and so forth. So I understand there are constraints like that, you know, which can, you know, because offering flexibility is important for us and there are some constraints on that. But there is a lot more, you know, we can do as an industry. And we have so much to offer as an industry, right? As a, you know, I mean, I can't think of any other industry that uses the breadth and depth of engineering. Mm. You know, think about it. Everybody from a petroleum engineer, chemical engineer, geologist, instrumentation engineer, electrical engineer, mechanical engineer, every type of engineering discipline works in our industry. Mm-hmm. It's just incredible. I mean, I can't think of another industry where that is a, such a breadth of engineering talent mm-hmm. gets into our industry, right? So there's a lot to offer. And I think it's you know, starting with a commitment to do that and breaking that unconscious bias that somebody may not want to do this as an assumption. Mm-hmm. We need to break that bias.
I love that. And, you know, when you started in your career, you worked, you know, on the shop floor, you started from the bottom to the top. And what's been very interesting is that you've never let go of those memories of being at the bottom. And I think that's why your leadership is so people focused, is because you remember those long hours and working on the shop floor. And can you tell us a little bit about kind of how being or doing those jobs early on in your career really impacted you on still making sure you take care of the people in the field and your workers? Because sometimes, you know, we get to the top or we work 10, 20 years into our careers, we forget about those, you know, the people that matter that are in the field every single day. So how has that helped you to be a good leader?
You know, it's such an amazing thing you just mentioned, because, you know, I'll tell you, every morning, that's one of the things I pray for, right? Is never to let me forget that, right? Mm-hmm. Because, you know, the reality is that the roles like I am in, right? You know, what I say gets done, right? So it's easy to feel entitled in these type of roles, mm-hmm. right? And what I pray for every morning is to make sure that I never lose sight and never feel entitled, right? So this is what I would say, you know, I say this to all my employees. Look, me being a CEO is a privilege for me. And I have to earn that privilege every day, right? Which means when I go home at night tonight, I should have earned the privilege to come back to lead this amazing organization, right? So I never, you know, that's one of the mindset I never want to lose, okay? So right, you know, working in those shop floors, you know, the learning about what's important and how what you as a leader do and what the type of environment you create, the type of training you provide to employees, it can transcend a positive culture in a company. It's not just a positive work environment, but it can transcend work and improve people's lives across. And that's one of the reasons we chose our purpose as improving the lives. So I'll give you a simple example. So when I was in Oklahoma, my first job, and I'm, you know, part of my job was improving processes in the shop floor, working with the shop floor people. And I worked with the third shift employees as well. And so I'll go in the night, spend time with them, training them on problem solving, you know, continuous improvement principles. And one day I saw one of our third shift employees in a grocery store, you know, and he was shopping with the family, right? And the operator, you know, he introduced me to his wife and children. And so we were happily talking about things. And then when he just moved aside to grab something, you know, the employee's wife told me, look, I don't know what you guys are doing at work, but I just want to tell you my relationship with my husband has significantly improved. You know, over the last months, he has been he's willing to listen to my ideas. He's more, you know, ask for my opinions and things like that, right? Now think about that, how impactful that is. I mean, and all we were doing at work is this idea of continuous improvement, where you teach people, look, brainstorming, you know, working as a team, listening to other people's idea, no idea is a bad idea, right? You know, we were doing it for work, right? Waste elimination, how do you eliminate waste? How do you solve problems, right? But those things can have a, you know, and that's the amazing part about culture. When people have positive experiences, their belief systems change, right? And you cannot turn on and off your belief system, right? And you see that all the time in your personal life as well. You know, the experience you come across, how that shapes your belief, right? And I tell people I travel around the world, right? So when I'm traveling in China, you know, in a remote part of China, when I see a McDonald's sign, it brings smile to my face, right? Because I can taste the fries, right? Yeah. I mean, that positive experience, right? You know, it's the same thing applies at work, you know, providing that positive experience all the way through. And the other thing I learned early on is the best solution is what the people agree on, right? I mean, I'm an engineer by training, right? As engineers, we are, you know, very focused on solving problems, and there is always one best answer you have to strive towards, but not necessarily, right? The best answer sometimes is what people agree on, right? And I think those are the type of things you don't forget, is providing those experiences people to continuously promote culture, because it transforms at times people's lives, you know, not just inside work, outside work.
Can you tell us what your, you know, perspective is on fear of failure, and how, like, maybe share a failure that you experienced and how you overcame it? Because especially in our generation, and, you know, the fear of messing up, or the fear of speaking out and not being taken correctly, you know, kind of holds people back. And that also holds your culture from developing. So how, you know, what is something that's happened maybe in your career or personally or professionally, that was a failure that you had and how you overcame it?
Yeah, I mean, there is a number of them, right? You know, as you go along, you know, never your career is this way, and you go through a lot of things. And I think that early in your career, I mean, this is very natural, right? You know, I mean, just like, you know, you're aspirational, you want to make sure you're doing a great job, and you're, so what happens is, you know, it's natural to think that when something happens, right, that you worry about what does that mean for me, right? That would that be naturally your first thought when you're faced with a failure type situation, right? And I always believe that people do their best work, you know, when they don't second guess, right? So as an individual, early on, what happened in, you know, so I was leading one of these big projects, right, which has got to do with outsourcing, you know, our complete, you know, buy of direct steel products to leverage our scale. And it's a very impactful project, because you're talking about hundreds of millions of purchases, which will, done right, will save the company, you know, tens of millions of dollars, right? So we came to an agreement, and you know, so the agreement was signed and everything. But 3-4 months into the project, you know, the project was kind of starting to go down. You know, I mean, there were a lot of complaints about, oh, we consolidated all our supply into this one supplier. You think, you know, we're not getting the delivery we need. We are not, all these operational problems came up, right? So clearly, you know, my first thought was, oh my God, this is bad. And what does it mean for me? And, you know, I mean, so what happens is you get consumed by those thoughts, right? You start second guessing, right? And luckily I had a great boss at that time, you know, so he saw that in me, right? Mm-hmm. So he pulled me into his office and he told me, so I just want, first and foremost, I just want to let you know, this is not about you. Right? We have a problem. You got to go fix the problem. Mm. Right? You need to quit thinking about you and quit the problems, because if you don't, you know, it's only going to get worse. Mm. Right? I think having the opportunity for somebody to tell you straight to your face and say, you know, it's not about you. In fact, in our leadership academy, this is something I always tell people, this experience, you know, because as a leader, That's one of the important things. It's not about you.
Mm-hmm.
The less attention you draw to yourself as a leader, the more time is spent enabling people to do good work, right? And so I think when it comes to the failure aspects, you know, I think the first and foremost is to get yourself, you know, not think about what that means to you mm-hmm. when you're faced with failure. But if you start focusing on solving the problem, you will have a better way to solve the problem because you'll make the right decisions, mm-hmm. you know, and that's what I would say.
Mm. I love that. Thank you so much for coming on the podcast. We've learned so much from you. This is why we wanted you on for the last 6 months. Your leadership is very contagious and, you know, congratulations for such a successful journey that you've had. And thank you for all your advice and tips to those listening who are going to be future leaders in this space. And, you know, I think what we've got gathered out of this episode is that people first. And at the end of the day, if you take care of people, they'll take care of your business. So.
Yeah. Well, thanks again, Udo. I'm grateful and humbled to be on your podcast. And it's such an amazing work you do. And keep up that great work.
Yeah. Thank you so much.